you, Isaac. Yes, well, this is really for you two. But seeing most of us, many of us here are married, then it has meaning for us all. I'm going to touch on a few of the passages of Scripture which relate to marriage. These are just a few. I did have a much longer address that I gave in Chilapatnam some years ago. I can't remember quite. I suppose it must have been translated so that the audience could understand it. And so I'm going to bring before us a few of the general injunctions, if you like, truths about marriage that are general to both of you and to each of us as couples. And then one or two about the male, the husband, one or two about the wife. And I'll give you a copy of it later on. I'm not going to ask you to keep referring to the verses in your Bible. I'll tell you what book I'm in, and that can be enough for today, I think. Mm-hmm. Because it's, I'm just wanting the Lord to address your hearts in this, and all of our hearts. And he asks the Spirit of God to speak to you as I remind you of these passages. Most of them are well known, a few of them are not. They're scattered right across the Old and New Testaments. Quite a few are from the Old Testament. Obviously, the marriage was an important institution in the Israelite community, and things were said about it that we need to think on. Of course, the one that we always have to go to begin with, really, is in Genesis, when man and woman were created. And we read that the man joined his wife. There was a man and a woman created, and they joined each other and were united into one. So that's really quite a deep concept. And Angela and I have always found ourselves remarkably united at quite a deep level. It's not easy to describe. David and Paramana probably find the same thing. You two probably find the same thing. And the younger couples here, they're probably starting to find the same thing. That it's as though we share the same spirit, the Spirit of God. And it's in a sense as though our hearts were fused some way. We in general understand what each other is thinking. And so we can perfectly believe that we become one. And when we met, we sensed that unusual quality of oneness. It's almost as though we can only feel fulfilled as the other is fulfilled. Which is really is a deep concept, isn't it? So we're looking out for each other, but much more than that, we're conscious of where the other one is in their walk. And if it goes wrong in any way, it concerns us. It concerns the one that's looking on, if you like. And that every couple will, at best, they will look towards resolving the difficulty. Not that that will necessarily be demanded very often, but our union has to be deep enough to be able to cope with those occasional crises, mm-hmm. which over the years are bound down to appear. Isaac and Gira have been married, they tell me, for 42 years. We've been married for 30, I don't know, 6, something. Something like that. I'm not sure. And of course, this raises one of the next points that we will look at about the permanence of marriage. Even though some of us may come out of failed marriages, we still believe in the permanence of marriage. You know, we didn't come out without a lot of difficulty and anxiety. And we can believe the Lord's remarks to us in the New Testament that he doesn't like to see divorce. Dwell on that. There's a passage in Malachi where Malachi is given a word for the Israelite people. And we can compare ourselves, our emerging married couples, like this, the company of Israelites. The Lord, in effect, the Lord is saying, I've witnessed your vows to be united with me, your God. So he's witnessing your vows when you take them in Dunedin. You're making those vows before him. And he is cherishing your faithfulness, your promise of faithfulness to each other. So marriage is something to be honoured. This requires each of the partners to honour the other one and like honour the state of marriage, to share the vision of marriage. And that's something that is mentioned in Hebrews. Honour your marriage and remain faithful to one another.
That's what the name Timothy means. Honouring God and honoured by God, yeah.
Good. That was a good choice by your mother. Or father. So if it like it, so you're entering into, all of us who've been married have entered into a contract before the Lord. If it was a Christian marriage, we were Christians at the time, then we believed that we were making a commitment in God's eyes. We're professing loyalty to each other. Loyalty is quite a complex word. It's often said that the Queen of England is loyal to the British people. When she ascended to the throne at the age of 20, whatever it was, 24, she, in her heart, she swore an oath of loyalty to the British people. Remarkable. And people can see it in her just steady, unbreakable desire to serve the British people. So it's a long time. It's a long-term commitment. It requires serious intent by both the partners. Only work if there is intent on and lasting content on both sides. It's not a casual contract that well occur in non-Christian situations where we know many people go through many marriages in a very few years. But in our case, it's seen as a sacrament of God. So it's quite unlike a civil contract. The civil contracts may have some prayers of commitment within them, but they don't have that spiritual underpinning that we have. it may require self-sacrifice, but from time to time when one of the partners is in difficulty and the other partner has to go the extra mile to enable the marriage to climb over that hurdle. And we should be ready to share in each other's suffering, which may easily be physical suffering. You know, Angela and I are at the stage of life where there's liable to be physical illness and pain at stages, and we each have to be there for the other one and help to carry them through it. You know, in a sense, we're standing in the gap spiritually for them while they're feeling really down. When I contracted rheumatoid arthritis in 2012, it got to the point where, yeah, come in, Ramesh, Shobha. There are two places perfectly for you. I'm bringing a short message, so you're in time. Yes, when I contracted rheumatoid arthritis, it became, and I had really no idea what the disease involved. So each day was a shock to me, if you like, and I got to the point where I found it quite difficult to pray, because there didn't seem to be any light at the end of the tunnel. I lost all control of my lower body. I couldn't get out of bed. I relied on Angela to keep going through all of that. And it's not necessarily easy for the partners looking on, because they don't necessarily quite understand the pain or the paralysis that you're going through. So all those challenges will inevitably come to us and you too at some stage. Mm. And the Lord will carry you through it if as you recognize your responsibility to the other one. It's not like living as a single person. So we need to remember that that's a good contrast. Those who've lived alone for a long time have to come to that conclusion. I have friends in England, and their daughter married he was an oceanic surveyor. He spent most of his time on large international boats around the world, connected with oil exploration. And he was in his mid-40s, as she was, admittedly. They chose to be married, and it's been a challenging marriage for them because he's obviously not always there. Long spells occur when he's not there. But beyond that, he'd had a long single life, and he really hadn't really rehearsed what it might mean not to be a single person. He'd only ever known the life of a single person. Built up a lot of sort of independence that it took quite a while for him to look beyond. Messages for husbands.
All or only
for all or husband
to
be. There's only one husband. But these were messages to husbands. but yes, messages for Tim, of course. In 1 Peter we get the verse, a husband must give honour to his wife. and treat her with understanding as you live together. I looked into the Amplified Bible, which is one that I know David and I both enjoy. Sometimes it's really quite revealing of what is behind the text. And that author says, so this is for you, Tim, show practical understanding to Vidya and tact in your relationship. So I guess tact means not saying more than needs to be said. Sometimes your partner may not be ready for any more words. And tact was a sort of sublime understanding. But enabling you to hold back and just let the matter pass. I think it's well known amongst psychologists that some couples are ready to talk about problems immediately, but there might easily be one partner who simply doesn't want to talk about the problem today, or even tomorrow, and that the partner who's ready to talk must simply hold back and let matters move forward, and recognize when the other one might want to talk. Marriages do need to be cultivated, don't they? I think you found sometimes that I wanted to carry on talking, and you had that. You just wanted to slide into sleep and not now. So I had a job showing practical understanding in that sense. In Colossians, it's quite an abrupt passage. Husbands, love your wives and never treat them harshly. Again, the Amplified Bible helps us get past this word harshly a little bit. Be affectionate and sympathetic towards her, not bitter nor resentful. Because, of course, if somebody is harsh, there are underlying emotions as well. Like maybe they are bitter about an event that occurred that has hurt them, I suppose. Or they might be carrying resentment that the partner hasn't recognised their problem, or is showing indifference, or whatever it might be. So we need to be gentle to each other. Harshness is really, it's not a fruit of the Spirit, is it? We know the fruits of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, and so on. And we won't find harshness there. And we need to avoid it. Angela and I have seen friend's marriage collapse, and the husband was very, very hard to the wife. Very, very hard. And that harshness was of such long standing that at the age of about 66, 67, she walked out of the house. So she gave it her all for 35, 40 years. She did honour the marriage in that sense. But there came a time when her own mental health really was suffering too much. The marriage wasn't returning anything to her. So I suppose that really takes us back to one of those earlier passages where we were talking about the two of you being as one. A marriage should never get to that stage that happened to our friend. In 1 Corinthians, there's an interesting passage. A husband has to think about his earthly responsibilities. And how to please his wife. Because Paul here is contrasting the married man with the single man. And I suppose it's a bit like that, the husband of our friend in England who was at sea all the time and had also been a single man for so long, that he hadn't ever thought what it might be like to have to make decisions for a family. His mind wasn't set that way. He'd only ever had to make decisions for his own career, his own meals, paying the rent, this sort of thing. But here he was with a wife and two children, and he needed to think much more widely, which he has over the years. But in his particular case, having been single for so long, it was a hard move. So that includes, of course, responsibility for, with your wife, of course, for the financial security of the family. And all that means a roof over your heads, food on the table, the bills getting paid. In my experience in counselling, I've noticed how there is a sense in the Christian community that the man needs to take a level of responsibility for the marriage as shared with his wife. Sometimes the men have to, with some difficulty, climb into this role because they may not have had that responsibility before, or it's not in their natural character to enter into decision making. So that usually leads to one of two things: either the wife takes it on, or neither of them really climb up to the plate, and decisions tend to get overlooked. So this is something that you will need to always address. In truth, decisions need to be shared, but both have to be active. Sharing those major decisions. I've only drawn out two messages for wives here. They're probably at least a dozen of them. I like this one. It's a quite unusual, very poetic. It's in Proverbs. A wife. Silence for the next sentence. A wife is a fountain of blessing for her husband. Pretty and graceful as a deer. She captivates her husband by her love. I'm not sure what the translation was. It's so long ago since I wrote that note. But that's the essence of it. Wife is a fountain of blessing for her husband, pretty and graceful as a deer. She captivates her husband by her love. So this was the early Israelite people talking. This was a saying that permeated the Israelite people in those early days. Very encouraging, really, considering that the Israelites as a society did not elevate their wives all that far. I mean, that was a general Middle Eastern attitude to women. And then the other one from 1 Peter. And this one is really important. Wives, your pure and godly lives will speak to your husband without any words. Effectively through the inward beauty and character of your heart. Clearly your husband has to be sensitive to recognize the pureness and godliness that you as the wife carry, or want to carry into his life. And I guess what Peter is saying is you won't necessarily have to speak any words to him. He will sense healing and the Spirit of God upon him as he observes your behavior. As I have often observed in Angela. When I first met her, the first thing that struck me as quite remarkable was how very calm she was. There was this pervasive calmness, and I mean, in modern society where there's a view that men and women are no different to each other. Apart from the fact that one can bear a child, the calmness might be seen as weakness or and always deference to the other person. But it's one of the amazing qualities that we see in the Christian life. Angela took me to see a friend of hers, an elderly couple, years ago in Linfield, and they were both just entering their 90s, and the wife put on this amazing lunch for us after church, and she had that inner beauty. You could practically see it. You could see it coming out of her eyes. But you could also witness it in the way she was so very patient with her husband. Who I understood from Angela, always told the same stories over the meal. She said, oh yes, I've heard them a number of times. And that's what Angela said. But she had this sublime demeanor. This is not to say that women won't need to speak up, but it's simply saying that women have that beautiful inward inner quality out of which and also wisdom, because of course Proverbs it remarks that I don't have it on this piece of paper, but women bring wisdom to the family. So that needs to be recognized by all our husbands. It seems to be a particular calling on wisdom, on women, that they bring wisdom into the family. So, Tim and Vidya, I'll leave it there. I praise God for your intended marriage. And,